Goose Green. Mount Tumbledown. Fox Bay. The Falklands, the Army, and the future.
Good evening. The Falkland Islands are garrisoned, protected by fighters and rockets and troops. And the islanders are trying to fit their lives together again in the fortress. But it will never be the same. TVI, the first program of its kind to report from the islands, found the debris of the past, the wreckage of war, the pasture perhaps forever sown with mines, the unforgiving memories of occupation. The test now is, can the islanders survive as a community? If the wishes of the islanders were paramount, many of them now want their own land to farm themselves. Otherwise, the young people will leave. The Labour Party here is making it an issue. Yet, as Peter Gill's report shows, even the worst of the absentee landlords are not being budged from Fortress Falklands.
A British foot patrol on West Falkland last week. It's now high summer. Not long ago, these islands were the centre of Britain's world. Over 200 servicemen dead, 8,000 miles from home. And this is what the fight was all about, a rustic and thoroughly British way of life. Sheep on their way to shearing. The battle is now on for economic survival, though the evidence of war is pervasive. At Goose Green, the grave of a Harrier pilot. Nearby, the shot-up Pucaras of the Argentine Air Force. For a while, Pucara became a menacing word in the British vocabulary, but they were no match for the Harriers. The Paras lost 15 men at Goose Green. Their victory liberated the island's largest rural community from Argentine occupation. 114 men, women and children spent 30 days locked up in the village hall. Their recovery from that experience has been swift. It's now business as usual, 100,000 sheep to shear. 5,000 can be accommodated at a time in one of the world's largest shearing sheds. It was here that the British kept 1,400 Argentine prisoners of war. Goose Green is one huge farm. Eric Goss, the manager, was decorated for his leadership during the occupation. His wife Shirley helps him count the cost. 800 sheep slaughtered, and that was not all.
You see, with all the sheep being mixed up, our pedigree flock was mated with whatever ram happened to stroll around the place. So the whole progeny from that flock for a year is lost. And that takes you years to recover, particularly when we've lost some of the last year's breeding stock as well. That sets you back quite a bit. As far as the structures go, rebuilding houses, places that were bombed down, burnt out, fences that were destroyed, removed, and filling in the foxholes, cleaning up the rubbish and tidying. And I think I'll still be doing that in 2 years' time.
Soldiers still outnumber residents on his farm. But their presence in Goose Green, as elsewhere in the islands, is more than tolerated. It is welcomed. For the garrison represents security against another Argentine invasion. And the Royal Hampshires patrol in earnest. The Argentine invasion last year came after the sheep had been shorn. And despite all the chaos of occupation, imprisonment and war, this year's wool clip will not be much down on last. That's good news for the Falkland Islands Company, which owns the farm, and for the British group Colite, which owns the company. But it won't make too much difference to the regular employees at Goose Green. Shepherd Tony Anderson is preparing for the winter after next, peat takes that long to dry, and the Argentinians used up what he had in store. Tony works for the Falkland Islands Company and is an islander born and bred. His sheepdogs share with him an unvarying diet of mutton. Of that, there is no shortage. His experience at the hand of the Argentines convinced him that had they stayed, he would have tried to leave the islands. Now he will stay because the British are back. And apparently here to stay. Across the water from Goose Green, the army is starting a new and permanent existence. Royal Engineers have been given the task of creating accommodation that will house the Goose Green Army garrison for the indefinite future. Physical separation has been ordered because the army fears future friction if soldiers continue to be billeted on the civilian community. In fact, the military presence in the settlements has had very little impact on daily civilian life.
Where are you going to after breakfast?
Tony Anderson and his wife Jenny would one day like to see Britain. This morning it's time for other arrangements as Tony prepares for 3 days shepherding out on the hills.
Well, this peat and sand is taken. Sell a deer out and they're going to Paragon tonight as well.
Brian's already ate them.
Yes.
The rewards, by British standards, are modest.
What's the money like? What are you paid?
220 pounds a month. That's the average wage. Then get cost of living on top of that. That's about 13 pounds a month now. I think it is, 14.
So it's working out at around the £3,000 mark a year?
Yes.
On top of that, of course, you've got a number of perks, haven't you?
Yes.
What are they?
Or free mutton, and supposed to be milk, but we're not getting it at the moment because of the conflict. They've got no milking machines and that, and they haven't turned up yet. House peat was supplied in, so that cuts the, you know, you don't have to pay rent for them, so that's a big help as well.
The pace of change in the Falklands will be governed by the British. And for the moment, the army's needs are the most urgent. Their immediate objective, to finish off the barracks before the fearsome Falklands winter begins. Building a Falklands in which civilians can prosper is more complex. Tony Anderson saddles up. There are no roads around Goose Green. He and the other shepherds are to drive shorn sheep back to the far corners of the Goose Green estate. They will be away 3 days, sleeping out. Like many others in these islands of huge company landholdings, Tony would like to be his own boss. When a visiting British minister spoke in Goose Green about land redistribution and asked how many company men wanted to be farmers in their own right, Tony was one of eight who said they did. He felt there was room enough when Goose Green Farm alone extends over 500,000 acres. Indeed, without land reform, there are real fears for the future of these small and dwindling rural communities. 6 pupils in a tiny settlement school. Without army assistance, they could not be certain of any regular classes at all. To his considerable surprise, Corporal Ted Musgrave of the Army Pay Corps found himself volunteering for the job of teacher.
Airplane,
what type?
Oh, well.
Right, so put Grandpa in there and his dad in there. Okay? Do his granddad blue.
Wouldn't you? I'm just gonna. Look at this mug.
Okay.
Early morning in Port Stanley, and the British garrison goes to work by landing craft. Their accommodation, a British Rail ferry in the harbour. There are some 4,000 servicemen in the Falklands at present, about half of them in Stanley, doubling the capital's population. Men from the Royal Engineers and the Royal Corps of Transport are transforming Port Stanley into a formidable military base. RAF Phantoms are now stationed at Stanley. They joined a detachment of Harriers. The jump jets were the great technical success story of last year's campaign. They remain on a very high level of alert.
We have to look at the fact that the 150th anniversary celebrations are taking place.
This is a British settlement here.
That is right, very shortly. And that plainly has a potential for aggravation for the Argentinians. I hope it won't, but it might do. And at the same time, of course, it's almost a year ago that they actually invaded here. So for those two reasons, I obviously am going to make sure that we're very much on our toes, as of course we've always been right from the outset here, because I would underline that unless we're here to be ready now to fight, there's no purpose for us being here.
Rapier, the anti-aircraft missile system.
Helicopter crossing left to right, friendly.
This one is guarding Stanley Airfield. Every aircraft movement is monitored. Under its protection, commercial life has resumed in earnest. Bales of wool from outlying sheep stations are brought into Stanley, over the top of one of the Argentine Air Force's last targets. The Sir Tristram, sister ship of the Sir Galahad, was also caught in the open during the landings at Fitzroy, the biggest British disaster of the war. The transport of wool from the Falklands, like most other commercial activities, is the effective monopoly of the Falkland Islands Company. No one on the islands really wants to see it out of business. As an absentee landlord, the company is credited with taking its responsibilities seriously, but the sheer size of its holdings are a political embarrassment. The Falkland Islands Company owns 43% of the land. Other outside interests own a further 4 estates on East Falkland and 3 estates on West Falkland, amounting to 76%. Further to the west, another absentee landlord, John Hamilton Estates, owns large island farms. One of them is Saunders Island. We flew to Saunders by Army Air Corps helicopter. If there is to be a land reform on the Falklands, it is said that Saunders and other islands owned by Hamilton Estates are the most obvious candidates for government takeover, subdivision and redistribution. Saunders Island was bought by a Scots shepherd, John Hamilton, who made a fortune by pioneering sheep farming in Patagonia on the Argentine mainland. The settlement on Saunders needs attention. And the farm, some of the best grazing in the Falklands, suffers from a critical lack of investment. Tony Pole Evans has been manager at Saunders since 1948. How much money the farm makes, he has no idea. With a lot of overtime, he earns £85 a week.
As an absentee landlord, how much investment have they actually been putting into Saunders?
Well, there hadn't been a great deal the last few years. None at all, in fact, the last few years.
When did you last have a bit of money spent on the place?
Oh, about 7 years ago when we got this big Ford track here. It's about the last time they spent anything big in the way of capital.
What do you think the farm now needs?
A lot of fencing, and we also need a rotavator to so we can get some of the rough ground chopped up a bit. And I think we'd be able to carry more sheep then.
How many sheep have you got on at the moment?
8,500.
And you could take some more?
Yes, we could take more if we fence properly.
Have you asked Hamilton's for this sort of thing, more fencing and so on?
Yes, I have asked for it several times.
What do they say?
Well, it just doesn't turn up. I put my order in, but it just doesn't turn up.
At Government House, we put the case of Saunders Island and John Hamilton Estates to Sir Rex Hunt, the Civil Commissioner.
I have no hesitation in saying that they are the classic example of the absentee landlord, and they are far and away the worst of our absentee landlords, and I would like to take over their land. I have written to them several times, and I've just been told to mind my own business. It's a private enterprise. But not only is it very neglectful of its land, it has good land, good farmland, which could carry far more sheep than it does now, but also it has Argentine connections.
Hamilton Estates do indeed have Argentine connections. It's a trust registered in the Channel Islands. Its last recorded revenue for 1980 was £61,000. We have confirmed that all the trust beneficiaries are Argentinian. The company has even filed a compensation claim for war damage. Land purchase by the government and redistribution to small farmers can and does work. This land was once owned by the Falkland Islands Company. In the war, it was a battlefield surrounded by the hills that the Argentines fortified outside Stanley. As British forces advanced, the farmer who lives here was forced to flee when Argentines occupied the house. He is Claude Morecambeau, and he has suffered appalling losses. Most of his livestock has gone, eaten, inaccessible, or blown up. Of his 11,000 acres, 7,000 are an uncleared minefield. Even near the farmhouse, they still find unexploded ammunition.
Claude, how did this one turn up?
Well, my wife Judy, she was looking for the day sheep, or she thought she'd seen one, and she just walked along here and spotted the shell after the bomb disposal.
Dead sheep, how many sheep have you actually lost from this sort of thing?
Well, I should think 300 or 400. I was just only guessing. I came across 53 sheep. It was minus a leg, and minus a foreleg, or something happened. Most of them were maimed, didn't you?
And you put them down?
I put them down, yeah. And I seen the cattle that we lost at that time. Well, they were still alive when the vet, Brian Thompson, organised his count from the helicopter and the shoot-up.
Nasty thing to have to do for a farmer.
It is, yeah. Makes you cry.
Claude Morecambeau and his wife Judy have been on their own for just 2 years. They have now had to gut the farmhouse and start again. They are still faced with mortgage repayments, but they believe they will win through.
It's a bit difficult at the moment till we know how much land we're going to have, but when we know for sure, then we can adapt and perhaps change our ideas about sheep and go into dairy farm. It'll take time, but I think we've got a few years yet to do that. I hope so, anyway.
And all those thousands of acres might just have to be abandoned?
It does look a bit like that, yeah. Mm. Well, I would hate to think of anybody getting injured, clearing it. You know, it would be dreadful, it would be on our conscience. Because I think the British have done a marvellous job, and the soldiers, you know, all the mine-clearing people, I think they've all done a marvellous job. I just hate to think that anybody would be hurt, you know, clearing that for us, sort of thing. Just as long as we know if they're going to perhaps close it down, as long as they tell us. That's all we want to know.
Government House, Port Stanley. An army helicopter helps out on the civilian front. On board, two members of the island parliament, both representing rural constituencies, both of them farm managers for the Falkland Island Company. The reason for their journey is to gain the ear of a visiting British minister. The link with Britain must be emphasised.
Councillor Bill Goss, member for Stanley East.
How do you do?
Michael Gager, who is our Attorney General.
Opportunities like this are seized. Talks with Junior Defence Minister Jerry Wigan will centre on relations with the Army.
Well, First Minister, I'd like to say welcome to the Falkland Islands on behalf of councillors and to thank you and the Ministry of Defence.
Sir Rex Hunt underlines the irony of all the attention the Falklands are now receiving.
As you know, we've had a number of ministers in the last 6 months. We had your previous Secretary of State, Mr. John Knott, my own Minister of State, Mr. Cranley Onslow, and most recently, of course, the Prime Minister. This shows how much things have changed since the 2nd of April last year, when we were very lucky if we had one minister's visit a year.
On a slipway near Government House, a further pointer to the return of civilian normality. A new Beaver aircraft is readied for takeoff. Before the Argentines invaded, the Falkland Islands government ran three aircraft, including a Beaver. All were destroyed during the war. The new Beaver was shipped to the Falklands in bits and assembled there last month. It has now resumed its service to the outlying settlements, where there are no roads, let alone airstrips. The Beaver's return, it said, has done more than any other event in recent months to revive civilian spirits in the Falklands. But nothing will erase the memory of the occupation and the enduring resistance it has provoked towards future relations with Argentina.
As far as I'm concerned, personally, and I think a lot of Falkland Islanders, it's going to be a very long time before we want to have anything to do with Argentina again. If you'd been here, and that street just behind us, and seen thousands of heavily armed, arrogant goons tramping up and down it in April of this year, you wouldn't want to have anything to do with them again either.
They are so fixed in their ideas that their talk of discussions are not really discussions, they're just talks about when we're going to hand it over, and we're not. So I can't really see much sense in going to speak to them at all at the moment, particularly where they're still rattling the sabres, you know, they haven't even bothered to put them down yet. We broke the last one they waved. So I can't see it.
Whatever British government takes over, after the sacrifices that have been made, they will have to reckon with the British Parliament and the British public before they go to the extent of saying to the people here, we can't afford to defend you anymore, therefore we are not going to allow you to determine your own future. We are imposing a settlement on you and we're handing you over to Argentine and we'll buy you out and let you come and settle in Britain or elsewhere.
Now, how enduring a factor is that going to be in British politics, do you feel?
Well, you're better placed than I to say that. I just don't know, but I would think, speaking just as an ordinary British civil servant, that no British government in the foreseeable future will be able to say, we can't afford to look after the Falklanders, therefore we are going to impose a settlement on them.
The frigate HMS Minerva, on her way to Port Stanley, crosses with the guided missile destroyer HMS Antrim on her way to sea. Antrim had a busy war, from the South Georgia landings to the 1,000-pound bomb that failed to explode. There are other warships in the area too, and an undeclared number of submarines. For the time being at least, no one can doubt the British resolve.
So, as Peter Gill showed, one thing has not changed in the Falklands. The pounds being earned by islanders the hard way are still being converted merrily into pesos for Argentine shareholders. And that Argentine firm is claiming compensation from the British taxpayer. Not because there was fighting on those West Falkland Islands, but because Argentine troops used bales of wool being stored in Port Stanley as sandbags against the British. Good night.